Good morning, everyone. It is a beautiful spring, isn't it? Speaking of spring and beauty, good morning, Ms. Marilyn.
Good morning.
Glad to have you here with me today.
Thank you.
And we want to welcome everyone who is here, of course, this morning, but also our online viewers. We're glad that you're worshiping with us and fellowshipping with us in the spirit of heaven. Our vision is to be loving people in our community and in our church, that's right. And perfectly reflecting the love of God is something that is a miracle that God performs in our hearts, amen?
Amen.
But we have to invite him to do that, give him opportunity, amen? I want to encourage you to join me in doing that. We have a few announcements, Ms. Marilyn.
Yes, a birthday to start off, April 13. That's interesting, April 1 and April 13. My mother said that her special number was 13 because God was more powerful than the superstitions that people had. So it was an interesting choice for her. But that's Ron Provant's birthday today. If you know Ron, give him a shout out to say happy birthday. Remember to look and read through your bulletin. In the calendar, there is Wednesday prayer meeting. You have your options now. Those of you who have been missing the in-person meetings, we now have the in-person meeting and Zoom, and it's going to happen in the Lifting Lives building in the computer room off the main lobby area. And so because being there means that on Zoom, you can hear what everyone is saying. As before, you could only hear the person that was close to the Zoom camera. So that's really great to remind you that at 7 o'clock, there's a guest meal today for our guests. If you want to stay through second service, please do. And we'll have lunch with you. Also, the Nampa Zephyrs mystery meal. I believe that's tomorrow.
And the mystery is whether the food is good or not, or what?
No, the mystery.
No, I can assure you the food is going to be delicious.
Are you announcing it? No.
I've got something else to tell them.
Okay, well, you look in your bulletin because there is a price listing because this is a fundraiser. So if you want to add 10% right away, do that because it's a fundraiser for our Pathfinders.
Misty has something for us.
As you guys know, I'm the new director for the VBS this year, and I am still needing help. Not only am I needing tribe leaders, but we're going to start putting the post-its on the window. Now, those post-its that are going to be in front of our little VBS display table over there are going to be for the extra needs that we have, that even if you can't help with VBS in person by coming and playing with the kids, you can help supply some of the needs, the supplies that we're going to be needing for their crafts, for their groups, and for just VBS in general. So keep an eye out, go visit that window, and if there's a post-it that you see that you can help with the need of, please take that post-it, and on your honor, remember, because I'm not going to know who's going to take what post-it, but make sure you donate what you take. There will be a basket underneath that table. You can put your donations. So we thank you in advance for all of your help with our VBS this year.
Amen. Thank you, Misty. On your honor. Okay. We have some business to take care of here. As you look in your bulletins, you see in the middle section, transfers, second reading, and they are all incoming.
Amen. Incoming.
First of all, is Ayanna Alexander. I'm not sure Alexander and Bayron are here this morning at first service, but they are wonderful, a wonderful couple. They're coming in, transferring into our church from, first of all, Ayanna, the Ewing Memorial Seventh-day Adventist Church, Lakeland, Florida, and then Bayron Godoy is coming in from Eugene Spanish SDA in Eugene, Oregon. Also, Mary Smith. Mary, are you here this morning? Maybe second service. We love Mary. She's coming from the Cloverdale Seventh-day Adventist Church into our church.
Amen.
Thank you. Also, Richard and Kathleen Musket, would you please stand and let us see you for sure? We want to say hello to you and glad you're part of our church membership. We love each of our incomings. We love to see that. And so is there a motion that we accept this, their request of transfer? There is. Second. All those in favor? Yes. Thank you so very much. Is that all of our announcements?
Well, I just wanted to pay you to notice the inserts, please.
And they're both about?
Well, one's about dessert and one's about baked goods.
Is there a health lecture after each of these? I don't think we'll need that, do we?
Praise God for our taste buds, and we get to heaven, everything will be good for us.
And speaking of praising God, let's do it in song, shall we?
Amen.
God, who has caused the light to shine upon our eyes, the light that is the knowledge of the God revealed in the face of Jesus Christ, a wonderful Savior. Go ahead and stand with us as we sing.
Thank you. Call to worship this morning is from Psalm 96. Give to the Lord the glory he deserves. Bring your offering and come into his courts. Worship the Lord in all his holy splendor. Let all the earth tremble before him. It's time for our morning prayer. Those of you who are able, please kneel. The rest of you bow reverently at your pews. Great God of the universe, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, we choose to give you the glory you deserve. We choose to worship you in your holy splendor. We choose to adore you as our Redeemer. We admit our sinfulness, our selfishness, and our distraction by things of this world. We choose to be faithful stewards in all areas of our lives. We ask for your help in honoring you with all our words and actions. Today we again bring you the people in our congregation who need comfort, who need physical healing, who need assurance, or need help in mending relationships. Thank you that you know and care about each one. We ask the Holy Spirit to illumine Pastor Mike as he teaches us about the spirit of Antichrist. Please send the Holy Spirit to touch each heart so that we can focus on worshiping you. We also ask you to bless the offering for Hope Channel International. Our requests and praises are in Jesus' name. Amen. Deacons, please stand for our morning offering. Our offering today is for Hope Channel. Please give generously.
I feel it. Come on, kids, it's time for the children's story. Hi, kids. Aren't you just cute? Okay, so in 2019, my kids, Stephanie and Andrew, and I went to Peru on a trip. So these are my kids. They're all grown up now. You kids grow up way too fast. After we had been there for a few days, we noticed that several of our motels were called El Nino. We didn't think much about it until we read on a wall how El Nino started. Originally, it was an orphanage. Do you guys know what an orphanage is? Yeah? It's where kids that don't have a home live, right? Yeah. The lady that started that ended up with 145 kids. She got to where she couldn't afford to take care of them anymore, but she wasn't going to abandon them because they were family. So she started motels, and she ended up with six. And the kids that lived there worked for her, which I thought was really cool. So, you know how when you stay in a motel, it has a room number, so you know where you're staying? Well, the El Nino motels don't have that. They have names of the kids that live there. One of the rooms that we stayed at, its name was Wilbert. We thought that was pretty cute. So we spent the night, got up the next morning, had breakfast, loaded up our suitcases, and got into our tour bus. And he took us to this place that sells locally made souvenirs. So we were wandering around, looking around, And my daughter said, Mom, come here. So Andrew and I ran over to see what she had found. She found the cutest little teddy bear I've ever seen. She goes, Mom, we have to have this teddy bear. I said, you're right, we do. It's made with First Cutting alpaca, which is the softest, but it's also more expensive. But we didn't care. We bought him anyway. And we're going back to the tour bus. And the kids said, Mom, this bear is going to do the whole trip with us. We got to name him. I said, you're right, kids. What are we going to name him? They named him Sir Teddy Wilbert. I thought it was so cute because, see, isn't he the cutest little teddy bear you ever saw? Would you like to hold him? Yeah? Okay. But you have to promise me to be really careful with him, okay? Okay. Not only is he incredibly cute, but he reminded us of that lady's generosity in taking in all those kids. Because when she started the motels, she didn't just quit taking in kids. One of the waitresses told us at one point she had 400 kids. Yeah, and thanks to the generosity of some of the people that lived in the, that stayed in the motels, some of the kids got to go to college. When they got done with college, they went back and she put them in management positions. So not only was she giving them a place to live and a family, but she was teaching them how to work. And some of the kids were adopted by other countries later on. In fact, some of them live in the United States now. But I thought that was so cool. And he did do the whole trip with us. I've got a bunch of pictures of him in my album, but we don't have time to look at the album. But I'm going to leave it in the foyer, so if you want to check it out, you're welcome to. There's pictures of him on my son's hat while he's drinking coffee. he's in the train on our way up to Machu Picchu. It was fun. But who knows where those kids would be now if she hadn't taken them in and given them a place to be. You never know. So I just felt like that was a God thing. For one, that we stayed there. We met Sir Teddy Wilbert. Isn't he cute? Pastor Mike, how'd you end up with him? Let this little guy hold him. Oh, okay. You already held him? Okay. Fine. Anyways, it was the funnest trip. Anytime I get to do stuff like that with my kids, it's wonderful. My husband didn't get to go because, you know, somebody has to take care of the farm. But it was still a ton of fun. And there was a ton of answers to prayer on that trip, too. So you never know, you know. God answers amazing prayers, even the ones we don't know we need to pray. So in my opinion, we need to focus on how we can help other people. Because to us, it may not seem like a huge deal, but to the people we're helping, it could mean the world to them. And they don't have to be really fancy things we do for these people. It can be simple stuff. Somebody drops something, you pick it up and give it back to them. I don't know. You look at somebody, it looks like they're having a horrible day, hold their hand and say a prayer for them. It's not hard. Sometimes life feels like it's hard, but it doesn't have to be when we help other people. So, anyway.
Thank you, Katie. And I would like for you to pray with me now, and we're going to ask God to guide us in all that we do, that we will be helpers like the lady that Katie told us about. Let's bow our heads. Thank you, Father God, that you love each one of us so much. Every person on this earth is your child, your special child. So open our eyes to see people that need you that we can help. Thank you for taking care of us now and blessing us. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you. Morning. Happy Sabbath. Scripture reading for today is from Hebrews 4, 9 through 11, and this one's from the NIV. There remains then a Sabbath rest for the people of God. For anyone who enters God's rest also rests from their works, just as God did from his. Let us therefore make every effort to enter into the rest so that no one will perish by following their example of disobedience. May God add emphasis to the reading of his word.
Thank you, joyful praise. And thank you for being here this morning. We, Marilyn and I, have missed you the last three Sabbaths. Three Sabbaths ago, we had the privilege of speaking and leading out in our sister church over in Oregon, specifically the Ontario Church. And the brothers and sisters there are just lovely people. And so I'm sure they would want me to extend their blessings and greetings to you. The last two Sabbaths, we were with my mom in northern Georgia, and we're visiting her and lifting her in our prayers. 94 years old. This morning, our message, as you can see, is entitled The Spirit of Antichrist. And it's really not to scare anybody, but it is to warn us and reinforce what's going on in our lives, not just what's happening in the apocalypse or the end of time, okay? All right, now I've got a little story for you. It's about the Rabens and their blue spruce. You guys have any blue spruces in your yard? Well, they had one in their yard. And it was causing them trouble. It was dropping pine needles and pine cones all over the yard. So what did they do? They called the tree doctor. The tree doctor came over and he quickly explained that, well, it's a blue spruce and it does what blue spruces do. Well, the Rabens weren't really satisfied with that kind of a short answer. They were looking for some remedy. And the tree doctor just shrugged and said, a blue spruce will do what a blue spruce does. There's nothing you can do about it. Isn't it interesting and somewhat of an enigma that we, in our own nature, are unable to do anything about what human nature does? Human nature will do what human nature does. Without the influence of God, it isn't good, is it? So we want to explore for a few minutes here. So we'll leave the tree doctor where he is. I'd like to propose to you that by contrasting and comparing two kinds of spirits, we can better identify and understand our desperate need. And if there's anything else that you hear this morning, please hear me encouraging you and urging you along with me to really counter the nature that we have and understand it but yet know what to do about it. And so understand our desperate need for the Spirit of Christ, which is the opposite of the spirit of Antichrist, which the spirit of Antichrist, as we know, apocalyptically, or at the end of time, or the end of the millennium, the Antichrist is, and all those who hold on to the spirit of Antichrist will go up in what? Smoke forever and ever. Well, as negative as that is, there still is some negative, there are some negative things that we want to look at and be refreshed by, if that's possible. The spirit of Christ, the spirit of Antichrist, first of all, the spirit of Antichrist traditionally and most commonly is identified as that power, that religio-political power, that system at the end of time that raises its ugly head once again and causes people on the earth to worship it and to follow it, forces them, all those who are willing to go with it. Now, I might pause at this point and say to our younger ones that Miss Marilyn, don't tell anybody, but Miss Marilyn has some things for you. If you count the many times that Pastor Mike says, the Spirit of Christ. The Spirit of what? The Spirit of Christ. Okay, so you can count them up. All right? So, traditionally, commonly, we think of the Antichrist as this apocalyptic thing that's going to come up. But let me tell you, it is something that developed and was conceived in heaven. We know that in the beginning of the Protestant Reformation, all our reformers, our Protestant Reformation forefathers, if you will, they all identified this religio-political system that at the end of the world, but even in their own time, back in the 15th, 16th centuries, they identified it as papal Rome. And we do as well. We believe that's what the Bible is pointing towards. And he is calling not only papal Rome to reform and to come to the truth as we know it in Christ, but also, not just Rome, but also apostate Protestantism. So, with that, let's talk about the greater aspect, the spirit of Antichrist. The spirit of Antichrist is not just that which comes up at the end of time. It is that which is an inherent part of our humanity. Our what humanity? Our fallen, sinful humanity. That, my friends, is the basis. It is the spirit of Antichrist. It may not be the Antichrist, but it is the spirit of Antichrist which is in us. And we are unable of ourselves to do anything about our nature, just like the Bruce Spruce, right? All right. Thirdly, the spirit of Antichrist within us is this supernatural fallen angels, evil spirits, opposite of that which we now find and are ministered to by the angels of heaven. We have the evil spirits that fell from heaven, and they are seeking to influence us, all of humanity, and the things that happen on this earth. So, the third person of the Godhead, the Holy Spirit, the divine being, is the one who is able to bring in the spirit of Christ and Christ himself to live in us and through us. So you have the spirit of Antichrist and you have the spirit of Christ. And the Holy Spirit is all about making it possible for Jesus to live his life in and through us. And counter, therefore, counter that which is a natural part of our person and our being, and that is the spirit of Antichrist. So the Holy Spirit is all about countering the spirit of Antichrist by the presence and the indwelling of Christ himself. So what is the spirit of Antichrist? Let's go back as as it were, a postscript of our series on the three angels' messages. I'd like to suggest to you that all three of the angels' messages are not only telling us about what is happening and what is to come and what our duty is and a call to worship the Creator, first of all, in the first message, but it is also a warning about a false gospel and a worship and glorification of self as opposed to our Creator. So you can see the first angel's message as a warning, but also as an invitation to worship the Creator as opposed to engaging and indulging in the spirit of Antichrist. Secondly, salvation by one's own methods. God's work in us is what his objective is. To work in us, to will and to what? Do of his good pleasure. Now, you'll recall that the second angel's message is about that Babylon that has fallen. That Babylon is referring to a spiritual falling away from the truth, falling away from Christ and what he has given to us. So Babylon really is about salvation by one's own efforts to save oneself apart and independent of God's work in us. No, we don't want God's work in us. We want to do it ourselves. We want to save ourselves by the fruits of our own labor, as represented in the story of Cain and Abel. You remember that. And also the Tower of Babel. Thirdly, the third angel's message is telling us about the Antichrist and warning us not to worship the Antichrist, that system that has fallen away from the truth. So by the forces of evil and the miracles that it performs, many and most of the human population will follow it, as we are told. And that's really a sad commentary, isn't it? Revelation, the 13th chapter, verses 12 and 13, kind of encapsulate what we're talking about here. Verse 12, apostate Christianity. What is apostate Christianity? Apostate Christianity is Christianity that has fallen away from the truth and rejects the full message of the true gospel, the everlasting gospel that the first angels is talking about. But it, that is apostate Christianity, which includes both Romanism and Protestantism, exercises all the authority of the first beast, as John the Revelator writes. And what does it do? It makes the earth and its inhabitants worship the first beast, which is that Antichrist. It is that religio-political system that will once again totally rule in the world. Verse 13. And it performed great signs, even causing fire to come down from heaven. Here's the deception part. Fire to come down from heaven to earth in the full view of people, and therefore they are deceived. Hey, look at this incredible miracle. This has to be God. This has to be Jesus Christ himself here on this earth. So let's go back to the biblical origin and descriptions of the spirit of Antichrist, and then we'll look at some of the spirit of Christ in the Old and New Testaments. First of all, the spirit of Antichrist was conceived, as you know, as explained in Isaiah and Ezekiel, both 14th and the 28th chapter of Ezekiel, describes that fall, that spirit of Antichrist that was conceived in heaven. In heaven, unbelievable. Unimaginable, but that's what has happened. And we have the effects of it here today on this earth. We know what happened with Lucifer as the Bible described it. And then it spread onto this earth with our first parents, Adam and Eve. Jeremiah describes what is not a pretty picture and something that is difficult to accept and see ourselves in. Can the Ethiopian change his skin or the leopard its spots? Neither can you do good who are accustomed to doing well. So what is this saying? Well, I'd like to suggest to you, in my own version, if people or animals could change their nature, if we could do that, if we could change our nature, if we could change the nature with its spirit of Antichrist inherent in us, then it would be possible to change ourselves into the spirit of Christ as opposed to Antichrist. But we cannot do that of ourselves, can we? And by the way, what's PMLAV? Well, it's Pastor Mike's Life Applications version, okay? Soon to be in your bookstores. Not. Jeremiah 17, verse 9, don't you love to hear this? The heart is deceitful above all things and beyond cure. Some versions say desperately wicked. Who can understand it? Who can comprehend it? Here again, Pastor Mike's version. The natural born seat of the human mind with its inherent spirit of Antichrist cannot be trusted in the least. It is an incurable condition. And without divine revelation, no one knows the depths it will sink. Romans, the 8th chapter, verses 6 through 8. The mind, Paul writes, is governed by the flesh, and it's death. But the mind governed by the spirit of life is life, and it is peace. And so you have these two spirits waging war against one another within our minds and in our hearts. Who is going to win out? It doesn't win out by one decision, does it? It wins out by a daily decision to embrace Christ by faith and receive him into our minds and into our hearts through his word. Amen? And that is the major way to counter and squash the spirit of Antichrist. Verse 7, the mind governed by the flesh is hostile to God. The way we are born, we don't have to learn how to be hostile against God. It's within us. It does not submit to God's law, and neither can it do so, Paul says. And that's awakening to me every time I read that. Our by nature, we are hostile to God, and we cannot change that of ourselves. Verse 8, those who are in the realm of the flesh cannot please God. That is the realm of the flesh. What is that? It's referring to our nature, our inherent spirit of Antichrist. Do-it-yourself religion. Examples of the characters in Bible? Well, there are several, and you can certainly think of more, having the spirit of Antichrist totally overcoming them. Let's look at a few. You'll remember these. Yeah, we'll come back to you, Noah. First of all, you remember Cain and Abel. How tragic it was for the very first children of Adam and Eve that quickly in this world's history. How could it be that the spirit of Antichrist can go so far within the human mind that early in history? It doesn't seem possible. To me, logically and reasonably, it would take, you know, years and years for something that awful, that terrible, that tragic as murdering your own, you know, loved one, your own brother or relative. It just doesn't seem possible. But that's the extent in which the spirit of Antichrist, uninfluenced by the spirit of Christ, will go. And it is within us. And it should cause us pause, great pause. I appreciated Bonnie and her prayer this morning acknowledging our nature, that spirit of Antichrist within us. As we acknowledge it and confess it to the Lord, we are able to receive the blessing that he has for us. And without that blessing, without that counter power of love and grace from heaven, the spirit of Antichrist can grow exponentially and accelerated more than we can comprehend. Yeah, Cain, He represents, his story represents what our nature is about. Our nature is to save ourselves, to do it ourselves and get credit for it, both of our in our own thinking and other people telling us how good and how great we might be. So he brought the fruits of his own labor. We need to constantly counter the spirit of Antichrist, which he is displaying. Cain is displaying the spirit of Antichrist and trying to save himself and offer a sacrifice that is not ordained by God. Have you noticed and you recognize in our world today, in the history of our world, especially through the Dark Ages and in the apocalypse, we will see this kind of spirit accelerate to its greatest form. However, there is a greater form in which the spirit of Antichrist has been displayed. And we'll look at that in just a moment. But it's incredible to me how they, even the antediluvians, the people that lived in the days before the flood, Moses, with all his preaching, was mocked and scorned and rejected. Genesis, how bad was it, the antediluvians? How far had the spirit of Antichrist gone? Well, the Bible describes it here. That's what it's talking about, the spirit of Antichrist. This is it. The Lord saw how great the wickedness of the human race had become on this earth. And that every inclination, how many? How much? Every inclination of the thoughts of the human heart was only evil. And there's no period after that word evil. He continues and concludes all the time. 24/7. 24/7 evil spurred on by the spirits of Antichrist and its influence on the world. Incredible. And of course, Babylon comes from Babel. Babel, of course, it's interesting that the flood did not destroy the spirit of Antichrist in human beings. It continued in the hearts of people, which tells us what? It tells us that we have this nature that has to be dealt with every day. And it can, and you know, even as we go to the Lord in prayer and invite him in, how difficult the rest of the day can be and how easy it is to fall to that spirit within us. Yeah? So Babel represents the efforts of humanity to save himself apart from the saving grace of the God of heaven. Incredible. It didn't work, did it? And then there's King Saul. A sad, sad story of how the Lord anointed him, gave him great gifts of the Spirit at the beginning of his kingly reign. God blessed him, and he prophesied, the Bible tells us, with the other prophets, was filled with the Spirit, but yet he had this spirit of Antichrist within him that he neglected to do anything about. And he wound up counseling with the witch of Endor, if you can believe it. This was a result of his neglect to seek the Lord in prayer and devotion and worship. And then wound up at the end of his life falling on his own sword. And then you have Judas. I've wondered about Judas. And some believe that he will not be in heaven. But I don't know. You know, when you compare Judas with Peter, it's an interesting contrast and comparison. I'm not saying that Judas will be in heaven, but I have to wonder about that. God's grace is amazing as we sing, right? Judas, along with the religious leaders of the day, they were filled to the max with the spirit of Antichrist there in the Garden of Gethsemane. And then you have Peter. Peter denied Christ openly and publicly and cursed and put on a display that fully could be recognized and labeled as the spirit of Antichrist within him. And certainly that's what was driving him. And fear and shame and remorse. It's interesting that he did not go the way that Judas went and ending his life. Are we all just terrible people? Is that what you're saying, Pastor Mike? You giving us another dose of how terrible we are by citing these Bible verses and experiences? No, my friends, it is true that we have this within us, but God in his mercy, in his grace, in his power has given us his Holy Spirit to live in us the life of Christ and Christ himself to mystically and mysteriously live within us in order to defeat and short circuit and crush the spirit of Antichrist. It doesn't happen just one time at the beginning of our spiritual journey. It must be something that is every day, and that's the proposition of faith. Faith is ongoing. It's a continual thing that we have to experience and exercise. Amen? The greatest expression, the greatest display and demonstration of the spirit of Antichrist was at the cross. That's how far the spirit of Antichrist within human beings will go. The howling mob, controlled by the spirit of demons, the spirit of Antichrist. Crucify him, crucify him. And then Jesus enduring what he did for us. It is chilling, isn't it? The depths on which the spirit of Antichrist, human fallen nature, will go. Incredible. It is frightening, and it should be frightening, but not left there. It should be dealt with by the grace and the power of God in our lives. And he will continue to do that. And he will take away all fear by the love of God. Amen? Amen. You know, I can't help but say at this point about Jesus and the cross. What does the cross say to us? What happened at the cross? No longer is humanity lost, but has been reconciled, as Paul writes many times. The spirit of Antichrist was crucified. That spirit within us has been crucified in Christ, in his flesh. That's what the Bible tells us. Paul writes, for if we were united with him in a death like his, we will certainly also be united with him in a resurrection like his. And so through the incarnation of Christ, through his becoming one like us, taking on humanity, we have become connected with Jesus, the second Adam, our second father. And because we are connected with him, what he did, we are able to experience and deal with the spirit of Antichrist. By faith alone in Christ, we can experience death to self, that spirit of Antichrist within us. And then finally, the value of humanity was displayed, was on great display, and was quantified, if you will, by the blood of Jesus. Are we terrible? We have some terrible things about our nature, yes. But are we valued? We are greatly valued to the max because of Jesus, because our Heavenly Father sent Jesus, his one and only Son, to this earth to not just demonstrate his love, but also to reconcile humanity and deal with the spirit of Antichrist within all humanity. Amen? So the spirit of Christ was seen not only at Pentecost, and Peter, the one who denied Christ, he was restored, wasn't he? You remember what Christ came to him and said, "Do you love me, Peter?" Three times. Do you love me? And in that confession, in that humiliation of Peter, he was able to receive the blessing of God and Jesus to be restored. And spoke to thousands of people after Pentecost who caught the message in their own languages and gave their hearts to Jesus. Amen? And the church began from Saul to Paul. Wow, you know that story. It was the Spirit of Christ that made all that happen. Awesome. And then you remember, it's interesting how Nebuchadnezzar is contrasted with Pharaoh himself of Egypt. Do you remember the story? God gave each of these men great demonstrations of his love and his power and who he was in heaven. One accepted, the other rejected. And that's how it is today, isn't it? And we have that choice every day. We must make that choice every day to choose the great God of heaven. And so it is. So it was with Israel, that they resisted and they rejected to the point of denying the Messiah himself. The spirit of Antichrist, that's what this is. Hebrews, the 4th chapter, verses 9 through 11, our scripture today. Spirit of Antichrist was displayed by the children of Israel. And we are the same way. But we are different in that we are committing ourselves to follow Jesus and embrace the spirit of Christ in our lives. There remains then this Sabbath rest, this opportunity for us to choose and to embrace the Spirit of Christ in our lives. Amen? Resting from our own efforts, turning from ourselves, and turning to life in Christ. That's the opportunity we have. For anyone who enters God's rest, also rests from their what? Their works. Works of what? Trying to do themselves, trying to save themselves, being independent of God's saving grace. Just as Jesus concluded his works of salvation, his works counted, ours don't. So we get to accept by faith the works and the merits of Jesus. Amen? Do we believe in salvation by works? Well, you have to quantify that. You have to qualify it. We believe in the works of Jesus, the meritorious works of Jesus for salvation. Amen? Let us therefore make every effort to enter that rest, that reliance upon God and his blessing, his spirit within us, so that no one will perish by following the example of Israel in disobedience, turning away from the opportunity to invite Jesus into our lives. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you so much for your spirit that was in Jesus and it is through the Holy Spirit and Jesus living within us that can counter that spirit that is within us that would reject you and go independent of you. We all recognize this, Lord, but I want to come to you on behalf of everyone here and everyone who may be listening and watching online. Father, we together, this is our opportunity and we're taking it this very moment to receive you now once again and receive you again tomorrow and the next day until Jesus comes. We are making that commitment just now. We thank you for your grace. We thank you for your reconciliation at the cross. We thank you for demonstrating your great eternal love, infinite love for us at the cross. Yes, we are sinners. Yes, we are fallen. But yes, we are valued to the max, and we praise you for it in Jesus' name.